Okay, you men.
Be quiet.
They're right there. We know they're here.
It's a
redress.
Mommy!
Did you hear something?
Redress, Rikon!
Alright, redress, Rikon! Everybody, be quiet!
At redress, Rikon!
I know they're around here.
Redress, right there.
I want to search this area.
Right here.
I know you all hear that. Find them now.
Baby, up.
The legal. I want this whole area quarantined. Mission now. Nobody is to leave this area at all!
Would you shut that baby up?
I know you heard that!
Make that child be quiet!
Find them! Find them now!
Shut that baby up!
All voices done by the Legal Redress Commission. None of this material is copywritten. Feel free to use it as you please.
Pretty good, wasn't it?
Ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen and ladies and gents, we did it again. Started a video out with Teddy Pendergrass and his "You're My Latest, My Greatest Inspiration." Of course I am. All right. People have been wondering.
Okay, I filed a small claims lawsuit like you said, but what do I do next? I mean, I just filed it.
Well, let's walk through the process, because a lot of people, they simply don't know the process, and for some of us who've been doing this for years, we know the process. Okay? So, let's explain the process. You take your small claims lawsuit, we put up a template, and we even did a video talking about filing a small claims lawsuit. As a matter of fact, let's get the name of that video, because it doesn't do you any good when we don't provide you with a name. The name. So y'all hold on 1 second. That's my download folder. We need to go to what folder do I need to go to? I got so many names up here. What folder do I need to go to? Oh, we need to go to my documents. And in my documents, we go to Big Assault. The greatest story never told. Got that on audio. Took the book and translated it into audio so we could listen to it. Now, small claims. Where are you at, small claims? Lawsuit for the masses. No, that's not it. Nope, that's another. Nope, that's not it. Mass action lawsuit. We did too many of those. The Buck Act. Update. Uh-oh, that wasn't supposed to happen. Change back to what you're supposed to be doing. Stop that. Sorry, touchy trigger finger. Small claims court. The new hour style money order in small claims court 11/22/2012. That's that video. So that's what we did. We explained all that to you on that video. Get rid of the desktop so y'all can just see the lovely background as it changes every 5 minutes. Less than 5 minutes. But anyway, ladies and gentlemen, after you file the small claims lawsuit, we told you in that video that they're not going to like the way you're filing it. They're not going to like you filing it on your paperwork with your documents. But you have every right to do that, because they cannot reject it because it's lacking in form. That is the Judiciary Act of 1789. So if you want to pull up the exact wording of the Judiciary Act, just put in "may not be dismissed because of lacking in form," or "due to lacking in form," in quotations in Google, and you will pull up all of the case law referring to that. What do they mean by lacking in form? That your document does not meet the standards or format that the court has implemented. You see, because you're not a lawyer, you don't have to follow the rules of a lawyer. A lawyer went to that law school thing. And when he went to that law school, they said, "Now, if you get out of line, we're going to tap that anus. We just going to tap it several times so that you get back in line. And if you don't stay in line, we're going to bar you from being barred." They're going to disbar him. So, attorneys have to follow the rules. But you do not have to follow their rules. As a matter of fact, that's not a single... Well, they can't make a law saying that you have to follow their rules. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, I came up with this today while I was driving, and I said, hey, I'm going to forget this, but I'm glad I brought this up because it reminded me of what I thought of. You see, they keep making all these stupid rules. Then the Supreme Court said something extremely unique. It said corporations are people too. Corporations are people too. And we should love them and hug them and kiss them goodnight because they're just lovely people who are just trying to make ends meet and get by. So if corporations are people too, ladies and gentlemen, as stated by the Supreme Court, corporations are persons, legal entities, legal fictions. Corporations are persons under law. They are individuals. Under the collective entity theory, they are persons. Well, guess what? I love it when the Supreme Court says that corporations are persons, because that means that we get to have one understanding, that no corporation gets to dictate to another corporation what it can and cannot do, that one corporation cannot spell out the rules for another corporation because that corporation does not exercise authority over the other corporation without consent. I.e., we can treat the corporations as if they're natural persons as well. How do we do that? Equal protection of law. What do you mean? They make the corporations and they put this corporation over that? Nope. Equal protection of law has not given them the authority to exercise jurisdiction over one corporation or the other. Sorry, they have not. Because your corporation is a foreign corporation. Don't believe me? Title 31 U.S.C. 1603. It's called the Sovereign Immunities Act, y'all. That was in 1933 that they came up with that. You see, they provided you a remedy, but you didn't see it because everybody else has been talking about H.J.R. 192 and the bankruptcy of 1933, but they didn't tell you about the Sovereign Immunities Act. The Sovereign Immunities Act says that you are a foreign state and you can walk into the court under foreign state status. But again, if the corporation is a person, there is no law which permits one corporation to exercise authority and or jurisdiction over another corporation that's not within its jurisdiction. So if the court, and I want you to really understand this, because this happened in Puerto Rico here, and I'm waiting for the results. What's going to happen is the court's going to start acting like you ain't nobody. They're going to start ignoring you. So what must you do?
What must you do?
Well, the first thing you must do is you tell the court, I'm sorry. You don't have the jurisdiction to do that. You've not established jurisdiction. And so you don't have the authority and or the jurisdiction to do that. And so, no, I do not accept. I do not consent. And your order is hereby rendered void. And you put it in writing. Just that simple. Uh-oh. I have one of my mortgage people telling me they'll speak to me later tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to bed in a minute, right after I do this video, because I am exhausted. And I said exhausted, not exhausted. Egg, like in eggs. I'm exhausted. Now, getting back to the handling the judge and responding, everything is they lack jurisdiction. They have no jurisdiction over the natural, real man or woman. They have absolutely no jurisdiction over the natural, real man or woman. You're not listening because I know you don't get what I'm saying. There is no law that permits and or allows them to have jurisdiction over you. I've been telling everybody that when I had the three tickets here in Puerto Rico, that the first thing I did was I filed a countersuit, which they continually said they weren't going to file. Didn't want to hear that. So I continued to try to file it. When they saw that I was being persistent, even calling the Supreme Court while standing there at the court and calling the federal district court and calling the superior court that's over the court I was filing the document in, all of a sudden they come back to me telling me that the matter has been dismissed without me even walking into the courtroom. Now I'm thinking about appealing that dismissal because I had a counter-complaint that had already been filed into the record. It just was given a different case number for which the judge is telling me I gotta pay filing fees. Well, I told her she had no jurisdiction to order me to pay anything. As a matter of fact, your order is hereby terminated, canceled, rescinded, and revoked. Take this back with you because I don't want it. You don't have no authority over me. I didn't give you authority over me. The fact that I filed that in your courtroom, I don't use the word filing anymore. I use the word record because I'm recording it on the public record, my complaint, my grievance. You accepted it. So by your acceptance, you accept the agreement as outlined. I filed it in English. We're going to proceed in English. And if you don't want to proceed in English, you better come and give me a law that says that you can't and you don't have to. And then I'm going to remind you that every law of the United States was written in English. And that Puerto Rico is a territory of the United States subject to the laws of the United States. And so if I, being a non-citizen national...
Wait, why aren't you a non-resident alien?
Because I will never be somebody's alien. I hear so many people talking about,
well, their law says I could be a non-resident alien, and that's the same as a non-citizen national, an American national.
Look, people, be whatever you want to be. Okay? You be all that you can be, but I'm going to be a non-citizen national because I'm not a citizen. I am a national, and that's all it says. I am not a non-resident alien because that means that I'm not a resident, but I'm an alien. Look up the term alien, something that's foreign, something that is not of this world, something that is not a part of.
Well, that describes exactly what I...
Then you be an alien. They call Hispanics from Mexico illegal aliens. So you be an alien all you want. But I'm going to be a non-citizen national, which is recognized under those ignorant laws that's set up within this country. As I stated before, the last video I did yesterday, that thing took 11 hours, 10 hours and 45 minutes to upload. You saw the time when I was finishing the video because it was on the screen. And you see the time on this video at the start of this video. Well, that video did not finish uploading until after 11 a.m. this morning. Okay, and I started it shortly after 12:30 last night. That was a monster, and it was only an hour and 38 minutes long. But that one, that video surprised me that when I woke up this morning, it was still going. All right, so let's finish with the court. So you got these judges who are going to sit up there and tell you, you must do this and you must do that. Then you remind the judge that this matter was filed under common law. And those are not requirements under common law. Now, if they are requirements under common law, please stipulate the law. And by the way, case law is not common law. So if they give you any BS British sovereigns, common laws, in other words, case law, then you simply say, I'm sorry, this law does not apply. Because it does not apply in this matter. And I'm sorry, but you have no jurisdiction to enforce your ideas, your opinions, your rules, your direction in this matter. If you are incompetent to handle a common law matter, then you need to send this to someone who is competent for hearing this matter. Now, there are some of you who are going to just want to follow the straight and narrow and do things the way that they have it and follow the rules and all that. And that's okay. It's not a problem. When you file the common law complaint or the complaint, I don't want to call it a civil complaint because you don't ever want to do a civil complaint. When you file the civil complaint, what you're going to do is you're going to send a copy of the filed document, not anything other than a copy. Do not send them the original. They do not deserve the original. You send them a copy of the filed document along with your discovery request. Okay, you must, and I'm going to suggest you do a discovery request at the very same instant as your service of the documents upon them. And if you really want to put a knife in their side, send them a next day service. Instead of a registered letter and a certified letter, send them a letter express. Now remember, all of you who are doing express mail, put a stamp on that express mail. Okay, because then it stays legal correspondence. Without a stamp, it is not considered mail, it is considered interoffice correspondence. So put a stamp on it. And then let them put their metered stamp. And remember, they must reduce the cost as a result of your stamp. In other words, if your stamp was a dollar stamp, they have to reduce the cost by a dollar. Okay? Alright, now how do you respond back to the judge when the judge tells you you have to do something? If you don't know what the judge is talking about, then simply write him back, "I'm sorry, I don't understand what you're asking." Just simply use the word asking, because he will never be permitted to order you to do anything. So you just write him back, say, "I am sorry, but I do not understand what you are asking." Now remember, you are only the user fruct, F-R-U-C-T. You are the user fruct. What does that mean? That means that basically you've been given and delegated authority and power to represent something or someone, and you receive the benefits of such representation. Okay, but your usufruct, you want to make sure everybody knows it's without recourse, without liability. That's all you have to do. And we haven't articulated that in our documents as straightforward as we just said it now. Sorry, I'm almost yawning because I'm really, really tired. I was up at 7, went to sleep at 1. So it was a short night, but a long night nonetheless. And I'm just now getting home after being gone all day. But got a lot of stuff accomplished. Let's not talk about the love we lost. That's Teddy Pendergrass again with the... this is a remake, so this is not with Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. Okay? This is not Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. This is they put together a group of individuals to help remake the song. So I wish it was Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, because I just love me some Harold Melvin and his Blue Notes. Not his black notes, not his green notes, not his orange notes, but the Blue Notes. Let's continue. Sometimes the other party is going to come in and they're going to hire an attorney. And the attorney's going to come in and the attorney's going to start acting like you're nobody. He's going to literally ignore you and he's going to speak directly to the court. Now, what do you do? Well, the first thing you tell the court is you don't recognize this individual. And the law does not recognize this individual until they provide proof that they have been hired to represent whomever it is they're claiming to represent. That a copy of the contract needs to be on file, and you have no recording of such power of attorney, and the law requires that their power of attorney be on file. Every court's rules require that that power of attorney be on file. You don't believe me? When you get a public defender, they have you sign documents. Because there has to be a contract. There has to be a contract. If there is no contract, the lawyer has no standing in the case. He's just some third party, just speaking. And if you don't speak up and challenge it, then he will be permitted to do so under presumption of law. So we want to rebut the presumptions that they have not put forth a power of attorney. And because this matter deals with personal, private, confidential information, then you cannot communicate with someone who has no standing. That's all you have to do is say that the attorney has no standing. Now they will have to prove that they have standing. What you've just done is you've just changed the argument. Because I promise you, when you file a case, they're going to put all the weight on you, making you prove everything. So now you start by making them prove everything. You make the judge prove that he has jurisdiction to order you to do anything. And you make the attorney, then move out of the way, Jennifer. Sorry, I stepped on Jennifer while I was sitting in the chair. She's just so close to me. Anyway, and no, I wasn't yelling at her. I was in my way saying, I'm sorry, knucklehead. Get out of my way before I kick you. Let's get back. You want to challenge them in such a way that it seems that you're naive. But then you also want to slap them in the face a couple of times and let them know, oh no, I ain't no fool. You get me, people? Y'all understand where I'm coming from? You feel me? You heard me? Okay, let's continue. Now that we got the courts and the attorney on their heels, because at first they were on their toes, they're coming at you as if you're nobody. Now you're asking them some lawful, not legal. You don't ever want to ask legal questions. You want to ask lawful questions. Okay, legal has to do with their stupid stuff. That's why they're legal counsel and legal this and legal law firms and legal. You don't want to be legal. You want to be lawful. Okay? You want to fit with the maxims. Now that you have successfully gotten their attention and asked for specific things, don't worry about it if they deny it. If they say no, they don't have to. You just simply respond back to them, I'm sorry, but that was not a preponderance of evidence to the contrary, to the original presumption, and so it is now a fact in this matter by your lack of response, and your lack of response is construed as a non-response. Just that simple. Don't worry about it from that point on. Once you let them know that they failed to respond in writing, you let them know in writing that they failed to respond in writing to your complaint, to your affidavit, because everything you file is an affidavit in a case. Everything you file is an affidavit. Why is everything I file into it's an affidavit? Because an affidavit is considered evidence in a case. So it doesn't, you don't have to file it on the evidence part of the record. An affidavit is evidence, especially when it goes unrebutted. It stands as facts. And when your affidavit is unrebutted, wait about a month or so, let it go unrebutted for 30 days, and tell the court that the time for rebutting the affidavit under maxim of law has now expired and cannot be rebutted. And so stick to the facts that are mentioned in the affidavit, because they cannot be rebutted. Even if the judge decides to dismiss the case, that's your appeal issue. As an unrebutted affidavit is just that, fact. I have a case in a federal court that I asked for reconsideration. You know them fools have not heard. I have not heard a word back from them fools. But the defense attorney never rebutted my affidavit. The judge ordered him to respond. I showed y'all the video where the judge even stated that the defendants have yet to respond. And it was more than 30 days. That's default. And it's a judge admitting it. He later then claimed that it was the complaint that he construed as an amended complaint, which he accepted on the record, was, what is the word he used? Unintelligible? Gibberish. It was gibberish. It's okay, because eventually next year I will appeal it.
You can't. It's been more than 30 days. You can't appeal that.
Yes, you can. If you've had a case that was dismissed 15 years ago, 20 years ago, 100 years ago, what you simply do is write to the court under that very same case number and tell them that you are asking and demanding reconsideration. I don't like the word ask. Tell them you're demanding reconsideration because your rights to due process and equal protection of law were violated, that the judicial official failed to act and he failed to prevent the further deprivation of your rights. Those are just three simple things you can put in that reconsideration, and it covers everything, every single right violation you might have.
Well, what's that do? He's just gonna deny it.
That's exactly right, and now your time frame for filing an appeal has just started anew. It's called manipulating their stupid system. I've done it for the last 10 years. That's why I tell you, I'm not worried about them not responding back to my motion for reconsideration. Because when I get tired of them not responding, then I appeal the fact that they did not respond. That the court remained moot. And when I do reconsideration, it's an affidavit. It now stands as fact in the case. And I sit up there and I use that maxim of law against them. People, this is what I do. So, you're saying, what do you do? What do you ask for in discovery? Well, you ask for any... Dang it, I don't have a copy of the discovery. I lost my hard drive, so when it crashed, all my discovery presentments were in there. So, basically, you're going to ask for any and all files, records, microfilm, audio, video, data... You give the whole gauntlet. And the word any and all means any and all associated with this account, including a full and complete and accurate statement of accounting. You do everything in a discovery. Everything you can think of. And don't worry about it if you forget certain things, because you can ask for those things later. But you send that along with your complaint and your summons to the defendant. Now they have not just one thing they have to focus on, but now they have two things they have to focus on. And if they hire an attorney after they were served, whoo doggy, you know that attorney's time to respond is now cut short, because it's going to take them at least 2.5 weeks to get an attorney. Now the attorney's going to try to ask for extension of time. He's going to talk about because he just came onto the case, but that is not a reason for an extension of time. Because notice the principal is notice the agent. Notice the agent is notice the principal. The principal was notified. They had 30 days. There is no legitimate reason for them to be given an extension of time. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, treat alike. I like this song. This is a nice song. Treat alike. Who is this, y'all? This is from the hits of the 70s, Volume 2. This is Cornelius Brothers. Treat her like a lady. It depends on if she's a lady. All right. Let's continue. Yes, I wasn't kidding. Sorry, you can't treat a hoe like a lady. And yes, I used that word. You cannot. Sorry. It's been tried. You cannot turn a hoe into a housewife. And ironically, even though I know that, I was willing to try it at least twice. And you have no idea how much I was kicking myself every day. Telling myself, no, I can be the one. I can help this person change. This person will remain faithful to me. You cannot change a hoe into a housewife. And I was willing to marry the individual. But I know to this day that she would have caused me so much stress. And the problem is, I would have stuck with it. I would have endured. Man. I have gone, and I'm just mentioning this just for the moment, but a total of 16 and a half years completely celibate. And
oh, that must have been very difficult for you. What's wrong with you? You got problems?
That was my choice. And when it comes to me, I am Caesar. I was just going over that in my head today, because I hear payback Caesar stinks to Caesar.
Well, I am Caesar, according to the system for which we operate in, the commerce system of today. I am Caesar. I am king. So I am Caesar. And so I get to make the rules. I get to make the choices, so long as I don't infringe upon another person's choices and another person's rules. Back into time. And I'm pretty good at that. When the only people that existed were troglodytes. Troglodytes?
Cavemen. Cave women. Neanderthal.
Now, where did they get this cavemen and cave women? Because they found some places that had caves and people had, they found pottery and all that, and they thought they were cavemen and cave women, and they thought that they were hairy. Ladies and gentlemen, a cave is nothing but a home. 56 degrees constantly. Those people weren't dumb. They were smart. Because they didn't have to worry about freezing to death. Look at the Eskimos building an igloo. Able to light a fire in the thing and it doesn't even melt. Those are intelligent people. So, can't call them Neanderthals. You don't believe me? We have pyramids that were built.
Oh, that was built by aliens.
Yeah, right. Every single work of craftsmanship shows that those were not built by aliens, but by humans. With superior intellect than that of today. See, what you don't understand, and nobody gets it, humans are getting dumber, not smarter. Look at the ingenuity. Look at the inventions.
Oh, they got computers today.
Ladies and gentlemen, computers have not advanced man, not one iota of a bit. We're still using combustible engines. Combustible engines. And look at the batteries that they're creating. The electricity. We waste so much energy with the electrical system we have here. You guys know the man, and I'm trying to think of his name. Dang it. Y'all know who I'm talking about. That engineer, the German one, the one that invented so many things, and he was going to provide electricity from the air. And I can't think of his name right now. And it's right there, but I cannot seem to think of his name. Vladimir. No, it's not. Was it Vladimir? I don't know what the man's name was. I know he was German, and I know that... J.P. Morgan really got over on him. Don't email me and tell me. Please don't email me and tell me who he is. I already know who he is, and if I needed to look him up right now, I could look him up right now, but I don't need to do that. What I'm trying to tell you is just the fact that we have a couple of geniuses that come along every 30, 15 years. That's not the point. That's not the exception to the rule. The rule was people were a lot smarter in the past than they are in the present. Why? Because man is getting dumber. How can you prove that? Well, it's the carbon copy theory. When you keep making copies of copies of copies, they degenerate. I have a stack of papers sitting behind me that I made copies of my declaration and so forth, and my apostille. And after I continue to make copies of copies, you can barely read the words on the final copy. That's what's happening to man. You don't have to believe me. Talk to the scientists. They'll let you know. We are not getting smarter. We're getting dumber. As a society, as a group, as a whole. All right. Sorry to get off on that little tirade. You know. Dang it, I almost had his name again. Anyway, let's continue. Now, what do you do when it comes to the first hearing? Well, the first thing the judge is going to ask you to do is to prove your case. You're simply going to tell him, I'm sorry. These hearings are not for me to prove my case. I asked for a jury trial. I get to prove my case before a jury, and they get to make a determination. And he's going to make it look like he's somebody. I'm sorry, you don't have the jurisdiction for that. And if you do have the jurisdiction, then you need to state it on the record. What's going to happen? He's going to be extremely quiet. He's actually going to get mad or try to intimidate you. You're simply going to say, I apologize if I've offended this court. But it doesn't matter how much you yell, how much you scream, how much you holler, how much you threaten me. The fact still remains is that you lack jurisdiction and you must prove your jurisdiction on the record before this body here, or everything you say is moot. People, go ahead and ask. Ask attorneys and see if I'm right. Oh, no, I've already shown you the case law. Laws you didn't know about? Jurisdiction must be proved on a record once challenged. Do you get me? So when he starts acting a fool, challenge his acting a fool. When he starts acting like he's in control of everything, simply apologize to the idiot and tell him that I apologize, but you don't have the authority or the jurisdiction to order such a thing. As a matter of fact, if you did have the jurisdiction, you would state it on the record. But because you failed to state it on the record, then everything that you say, acting as if you have the authority and or jurisdiction, is moot until you provide proof on the record as to your jurisdiction. And until such time as jurisdiction has been reestablished, the jurisdiction for this matter is the original filing under common law. Under common law rules, to be heard before a common law jury. It's a Seventh Amendment entitlement. You see, the First Amendment, the Fifth Amendment, the Sixth Amendment, the Seventh Amendment, the Eighth, no, not really the Eighth Amendment, but the Ninth, Tenth, and Eleventh Amendments are all secured amendments. What do you mean by secured? Well, it's basically like you put something in a safe, you turn that combination, and nobody can get in it because they need to know the combination. Well, those of us who know the combination, we know that those are the secured amendments. Those are the amendments that they can't get around. The Seventh Amendment says, in any controversy that exceeds the value of $20, the individual shall have the right to a common law trial before a common law jury under common law rules. Common law rules, yeah! Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, this is where we stab them in the jugular. And in the First Amendment, oh, I have every right to petition. And you, nor Congress, nor anyone else can make a law telling me I can't petition. Okay? And then the 10th Amendment and the 11th Amendment, oh, you ain't got no authority in the first place because you have no judicial power. So from where do you derive your power? From where do you derive your authority? Under the statutes of blah, blah, blah. I'm sorry. Statutes. Statutes are not law. Yes, they are. Statutes are not law. And if you derive your power from a law, that law does not exercise authority over the people of the state of whatever it is. Remember, every constitution says that the rights are retained by the people and that the laws come from the people. The unique thing about equal protection of law, no man has the right to rule over another man. Imagine that. And due process says that they must follow the process. Not a process they created over the last 15 years. But the process as it exists under maxims of law and common law. These are where they're having their problems. Now, they're still dismissing cases, and that's okay. But if enough of us challenge them on the fact that they must prove jurisdiction, hey, life goes on. Because they will have to change. Ladies and gentlemen, you see the picture in front of you? That's a picture of, apparently, the Earth from the moon. Now, that's a lie, but, you know, they said they took it from, you know. Well, let me explain to you what's going on. What you're going to find is every time you see a picture of the astronauts or anything from space, they're always on the dark side of the planet. They are never on the sunny side of the planet. Why?
Well, why is that? You're absolutely right. Every picture I ever seen, it's always like it's nighttime and they need lights or something.
Exactly. Because the Earth would shield them from the radiation coming from the sun, which is trillions of times more than it is if you're standing on the planet. and they don't have anything to protect them from that radiation. So, when they are in space, they use the Earth to protect them from that radiation. And, as you know, they can't stay in space for too long because the radiation is still there. And the equipment only provides them a little bit of shielding. You don't believe me? Notice how often they were changing people on the space station, and the people in the shuttle would go up there and pull down the other people from the space station. Why are they doing that? Because they know that people who stay in space for a long period of time, they go crazy. They lose their minds. You must be out of your mother... I'm sorry. That's exactly the case. I just wanted to bring that as a side note. Now, people, what if a judge dismisses your case? You don't know how to file an appeal. You've never filed an appeal before. Well, it's simple. It's actually easy. If you want more time to do your appeal and you want to do it sort of a little bit better than haphazard, then you ask for reconsideration. It will take at least 15 to 25 days for them to respond to your reconsideration and to deny it. By that time, you're going to take your complaint. Instead of making counts, you're going to say, and by not allowing this to be brought before a jury, they violated my right to due process. And you mention each one of the points you were bringing out as counts, as the court literally conspired to block your having this to be brought before a jury, which you have as a common law right. See, if more of you would file small claims lawsuits, it would clog the system. And they can't dismiss all of them because now they would have to change law. Because now the courts are going to start narrowing themselves into a boxing themselves into a corner when they say, well, the court could do this and the court could do that based on this and based on that. Once they do that, they just changed the whole system for everybody else. And if they do that enough, they just created so much a small box that even the lawyers won't be able to operate. Some of you will get what I just said, so let me see if I could explain it again. All the kids are out there in the park, and they're having fun. But one kid, Tommy, he throws sand in little Susie's hair. Well, Susie runs back and tells the teacher. Tommy has to go sit in quiet zone. But wait a minute. John and James take sand and they throw it in Susie's hair. Susie goes back and tells the teacher. Now, James and John are sitting in a little quiet box. Well, now all the boys and then some of the girls start throwing sand at little Susie. Now, all of the kids are sitting over there in the little quiet zone and Susie's out there all by herself. You know what Susie's doing? She's just throwing sand up in the air. It's getting in her hair. It's getting everywhere. See, if they were to sit up there and dismiss everyone's case, that would just leave one or two people standing out there by themselves having success, which means it would make it very difficult for the lawyers to practice and have a living, which means that they would complain, which means that they would have to correct a lot of the wrongs because they would have no other choice. So when the teacher sees little Susie sitting up there throwing sand and stuff in the air, the little teacher realizes that Susie's the problem, but she doesn't put Susie in timeout. She gives Susie an assignment. Yeah, she makes Susie a judge. You get me? Because that's exactly what they do. Because that's the type of person they want running things. So Susie gets to watch all the other kids play. And if anybody gets out of line, then Susie gets to sit up there and tell the teacher. That's the pot and the kettle thing. Well, that's what the courts are doing right now. That's why the good so-called judges don't get to be good so-called judges. And that's why a lot of good judges are not there right now. Because they hire all these would-be ignorant mother... Thomas. No. Robert. What is his name? Thompson or whatever. Roberts. I'm sorry. Roberts. I said Thomas. In other words, Roberts of the Supreme Court. I don't think that he is as bad as I make him out to be. some of his decisions seem to be tempered with reasonableness, and I'm a little surprised at that. Scalia and talks about Thomas. I can't stand Clarence Thomas. Not because of his skin color, but he shouldn't have been where he is in the first place. He's only there because of his skin color. You don't believe me? Go back and look at his nomination.
Look at that. Since Thurgood Marshall, since we had that last black person, he died, we gonna put another one in there.
Really? You gotta be kidding me. You put a person on that court because of their skin color? That qualifies them? Shouldn't their allegiance to justice, mercy, and sternness to the principles set out in the laws of the United States be the qualification? Their experience? And whether or not they've had cases filed against them for violating someone's rights and entitlements? Should those not be the criteria and the benchmarks? But that's not the case. Because they want to know how somebody would rule on an issue of abortion.
Well, yeah, abortion is a big subject in the United States.
No, it isn't. The United States aborts babies all the time. They even kill adults. So it's not a big subject. This is the one of the only superpowers that does capital crimes, where individuals get murdered by the electric chair, or what's that nice little needle thing they put in people's arms? Okay, people, that's just as barbaric as the actual act that caused somebody to lose their life at the hands of the person who purportedly or supposedly was the one who killed the person in the first place. Hey, I like this song. I like when Coca-Cola did it. Hey, I literally like this song, people. All right, let's get back. That's been our situation here in this country. Everybody thinks it's a democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not a democracy. I talked with someone today, and he talked about how he was nervous because he filed a civil complaint in small claims court. They asked him, how much is the amount you're suing for? He says, this is a claim in excess of $20.
Well, you want us to put that down?
No. He literally told them unspecified damages, but they didn't hear it in what he was saying. He just told them it exceeds $20. So they put $20. So what will he do? He will listen to this video, because he will listen, and he will go in when he speaks to the judge for the first time. There is a problem with this filing.
What's that?
Well, it says that I am demanding $20. Nowhere in my complaint do I demand $20. I am demanding unspecified damages as a result of I sent them payment, and they refused payment and were out of time when they refused payment. As a matter of fact, I asked for a full accounting because it was a car loan. Everybody, you don't understand. Your car loan was paid off the moment you signed a contract. So all you have to do is ask for a certified statement of accounting. You do it in court. Ask for that during your discovery. And just say, and they have yet to provide it. This automobile has been paid off a long time ago.
Well, do you have proof?
Oh, yes. It's in the accounting statement. I just told you that I paid it off. And now, in order to support the fact that I paid it off, I demand that they provide, as I'm allowed, permitted under law, a certified statement of accounting. Uniform Commercial Code, Article 9. Okay? The judge is going to tell you it's up to you to prove everything. No. I'll prove it after I get discovery. because it's in the discovery. The proof is in the discovery. Oh, and by the way, I apologize, sir. You can call him sir, but Your Honor, I don't call people Your Honor. I apologize, sir. Or I apologize, ma'am. I ain't your ma'am! Well, I apologize, ma'am. But the issue here is jury trial was demanded. And until we reach trial, I don't have to prove anything.
Oh, yes, you do have to prove it. You have to provide proof.
No. This is not a preliminary hearing, is it? If this was a preliminary hearing, then yes, I would have to produce evidence, and I will produce that evidence. When we receive discovery, it will support my evidence. But my evidence is the affidavit that you have there in your hand.
I don't have an affidavit. I just had a complaint.
Oh, I'm sorry. You misunderstood. That is an affidavit. And when it goes unrebutted after 30 days, it stands as fact in this matter, which means it is all the proof I need provide this body as of this time. That is a maxim in law, ladies and gentlemen. An unrebutted affidavit stands as fact in law. I've done way too many videos on this. If you want to go back and look at the videos on the laws you didn't know about, I talk about it so many times. So now I'm giving you what I would say to an idiot sitting on a bench. I know there are a lot of other people.
Well, I wouldn't go about it that way. That's just a way. That's you just causing arguments. And
excuse me, you're not causing arguments. They're the ones causing the arguments. What I'm giving you is a way to respond to some of those stupid arguments. You heard me? All right. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I could make this an hour longer talking about more issues that come up in court. But we're going to do two more videos talking about small claims. Little things that can come up after discovery. Other questions that you will be asked by the judge. And certain comments, because the next one will be demurring your case, asking for a dismissal. That's basically what a demur is, where the attorneys ask for a dismissal. Okay? Your complaint can never be dismissed for failure to state a claim by which relief can be granted. That is a lie. That is a lie. Because if you do it by way of affidavit, then you have not failed to state anything. You've actually stated everything. An unrebutted affidavit stands as fact. So then, if the judge dismisses it, that means the judge is agreeing that those rights were violated. Which means that now the judge is violating your rights by dismissing a matter when the evidence and facts in front of her expressly explain exactly what the issues are. See, I have about 6 dismissals this past 2 years that's the issue. Because I do everything affidavit. Everything is affidavit. And I didn't do that originally. I just started doing that over the last 5 years. But everything is an affidavit. Everything is an acknowledgement. Everything is a presentment. Everything is a declaration. Everything. Declaration. You see it on my documents when you see it. Declaration, affidavit, acknowledgement, presentment. I even have it on a granted assertion of rights. Because everything I do is that. I am a state. The head of state. I do declarations. I do executive orders. You understand? You heard me? Even the Declaration of Providence is an executive order. And many of you can put executive order on there if you would like. But it technically, in all sense of the word, when it says act of state, it's an executive order. But it's an act of independent state, you know. It's an interesting wording. That will have success for the first couple of months, and then when because they watch these videos. I got attorneys in Arizona, attorneys in Texas, attorneys in California. Where else are they bringing up my stuff? Ohio. I got attorneys in New York, Washington, D.C. They're bringing in my site and bringing up my paperwork, and New Mexico. They're bringing up my stuff. Telling everybody that they're getting it from my site. People, if you go to my site, there is no information on my site that is not supported by some type of fact or proof. So my site is not one of those fly-by-night sites where the information is like a blog spot where the individual is just giving you their opinion. The videos is where I'm just doing the talking. But the website, that's all documented information. You'll see the case law in there.
Wait a minute. Can you show us an example?
All right. Let's open...
Open says me.
This is what we're going to open. And we got to get rid of this junk here. I got to restart my... refresh it. Because all this time, I didn't have Flash installed. I have it installed now, but it's not working. All right, won't be able to do it on this one. I gotta pause y'all for a second. One moment. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, because I have not refreshed my internet connection, I am downloading a file from someone right now. Because I have not refreshed my internet connection, this is the old look for the site. The site has been updated. But this is CFR, Code of Federal Regulations, number 92, definitions. Then, every state law must conform. Wait, let's do this. We have, every state law must conform, private property versus estate. Terms of state define, let's see another one, restore credit, private criminal prosecution, the law of trust, credit report dispute letter, trading with the enemies act, controller of the currency. You see, there is no place on this planet that they can go to say that this site is opinion. As a matter of fact, let's go to the home page. This has been updated since. But let's see what the home page says, because I'm a little interested. Thank you for visiting the Legal Redress Commission. This was updated 9/19/2012. The scrolling bar is right here. That's what I'm using. Okay. New material include restore your credit score, restore your credit score tab. Also, material under the debt and more home tab. Check it out. It might surprise you. It has been our mission to help those who are unable to fully and completely help themselves. There's something said. Everyone needs to know. We do not have all of the answers.
No, you're admitting you don't have all the answers. What's wrong with you?
That is to say, many of the items that you will find on this site, any information you will find at youtube.com/user/redressright, has taken quite some time to put together. Most of the spell corrections have been corrected. Most of it is not complete, which means you will have to do the homework and research to verify the information. There is a lot of misinformation and disinformation on the web due to strategy. Yes, the idiots have done this on purpose so that they could say,
they got that from the internet, your honor.
You can't have all of the sheeple waking up at the same time. One of the first things we want to convey to you is that there is no such thing as a straw man, straw person, or any other fictitious character. It is all about title and contract. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a fictitious person, legal name, a fictitious this, a fictitious that. Yeah, those things exist, but do you understand that they do not exist in reality? As I stated in the video yesterday, if you look at the reality, you created all of it. You created the straw man. Your parents created the straw man. And when you turned 18, you assumed ownership of that vessel. If you don't believe me, go back and look at it. The government doesn't create the so-called all caps name. Just because they give it an all caps name does not make it theirs. You do understand that, don't you? Who gives them the name in the first place? Is it not you? Then how can they create something when they were given that something by someone else? Now, the way I got this understanding is when I did the name change. And as I said in the last video, I changed my name from a name that I had just created. I just made the name up because my birth certificate didn't have a name. And they told me I needed to give them a name. And so I made a name up just out of the blue. And They gave me a driver's license under that name. And then another state refused to give me a driver's license under that name. They went by the birth certificate and they called me NFN. No first name. And that was my driver's license. Just initials. MFN. I am not joking with all of you. Well, that helped me to understand that I was creating this. They weren't creating that. They were going off of the information I gave them. So how in the world are any of you claiming that they created these entities when all of the information comes from you? And you have to stand up and take responsibility for your creation, because you are responsible for the monster you created. I'm sorry, it's not really a monster. It could be an angel, or it could be a teddy bear. But it's a monster if you don't gain control of it. Because then it'll be out there doing all kind of stuff, and you don't even know what it's doing because you lost control. That's why they're trading things on the market in your name. That's why the document takes back control, terminates, dissolves contracts, dissolves the SESTA KV trust, the all U.S. corpse document, the dissolution of trust document. Those documents are still viable, and I do say still use that to file a miscellaneous court filing.
Well, they told me that every time I file in a miscellaneous case that I gotta pay.
That's a lie. A miscellaneous case is a case. It has a case number. And all you're filing into that is additional presentments and or attachments. That's it. As evidence. You're filing further affidavits as evidence. Okay, I have several miscellaneous cases that are still open in Arizona that I filed as criminal complaints against individuals. Never went nowhere. They just filed them as miscellaneous cases. Had a case number and so forth. Amazing, ain't it? This is what they do. This is our world. But despite the fact that people are saying this or people are saying that in their stupidity, we're going to let that go. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to end this video here, and I'm going to tell all of you have a very good day, and I hope this information proved helpful. Got to answer the phone.
Legal Redress Commission.
Redress right back.